In this video, I interviewed the founder of Vapi, an AI voice agent development platform that I have previously covered on the channel. In this interview, we will discuss the future of AI voice agents, the most in-demand use cases for AI voice agents today, and what the new real-time speech from OpenAI means for them. Those of you who don't know, can you explain a little bit about Vapi, what it is, and what you're trying to do there?
Yeah, so Vapi is a voice agent infrastructure platform. So if you are an enterprise, a developer, an engineering team, and you want to deploy a voice agent, whether that's in your telephony or in your product or wherever else, we are the easiest way to do that and provide all the APIs and customizability to build literally whatever you want on top of us.
Yeah. All right. Well, can you tell me a little bit about your background as well, how you actually came to co-found Vapi, how you actually came up with the idea in the first place, and what your goals are from that perspective?
Yeah, me and my co-founder worked on a calendar app for maybe like 3 years prior to this. Okay. And it was semi-successful and everything, but it was just really hard to grow. And I don't think it was technically challenging enough. So we decided to pivot and move to San Francisco. And in that process, it was so difficult that I built an AI therapist for myself to go on walks with for like 2 hours.
Wow, okay.
And so 2 hours a day talking to my AI therapist, the remaining, I don't know, however many, except for sleep, just like building it, and then kept doing that for like 2 weeks or so. So I got very familiar with the voice stack and where all the gaps were, and was very frustrated when I had to keep talking on long run-on sentences for it to, like, you know, not interrupt me while I was speaking. And I just got obsessed with this problem. And after maybe a month or two of that, we thought it was going to be a therapy platform, realized that wasn't really the move for us, and instead decided to provide like what we had built to other startups who were also building voice stuff. So one in particular was Hyperbound. They do like sales role play training. And so they used us in their product to like pretend to be like customers who don't want cold calls to help salespeople like practice their cold calling. And over the next 6 months, we found maybe like six or seven different startups to work with who are building different stuff in voice across like customer service and sales and all sorts of other niche use cases. And we found like where we stopped and where their platform started and found the commonalities and what they all needed. And so we just, kept building out the platform to the point where we thought it was ready to launch. And then we launched in March of this year. And ever since then, voices, you know, definitely had a moment. And so we are riding that wave and then hoping to continue making it easier for more people to get in on it so that the wave keeps going and we bring voice to the world.
Yeah, that's awesome. So you clearly found that use case through the therapy app as well as the sales training. It was a direct understanding of what was capable in the market and you just went straight for it. That's awesome. Awesome. Well,
yeah, like all the raw materials were there, but it was really hard to put them together. So there was a lot of value in putting them for other people.
Yeah, of course. So what actually inspired you to dive specifically in AI in the first place? Why did you go for AI? And then why did you even build AI voice? Did you think it was just the most natural to speak with in terms of AI? What was the sort of thought process there?
I mean, I've always wanted to work in AI. Like I was a big Ray Kurzweil fan. He's like a futurist thinker on AI way back from when I was like 15 years old. And so I always knew AGI was coming. I didn't think it would come so soon. And so was always very interested and then, you know, went down a different path and then ChatGPT came out and I was like, oh shit, okay, it's actually happening. Well, yeah, I'll probably do something here. And then I think I just realized that I fucking hated texting and I don't think that text is really the interface that's going to unlock AGI. I think it has to be voice, right? There's a reason that we're talking right now. It's because this is the way that we have, you know, for hundreds of thousands of years, like communicated with each other. And it's the way that we should communicate with technology, except like we've been warped behind our keyboards and now I have like neck slouch and all sorts of other issues from like click on keyboards and stuff. And like, that's just not the world that I want on a 10 to 50 year time horizon. I want a world where everything is done via voice and technology warps to us. And so that's what I wanted when I wanted my AI therapist. And then that quickly grew into the vision it is today. It's like providing it for every use case.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's obviously, it's a lot easier to speak than it is to type on your keyboard mashing. Yeah. So that makes a lot of sense. So yeah, well, I think we're seeing a lot of adoption of these AI phone callers now. Like on my channel, I've covered quite a few builds and client builds that we have done. So do you think there are, or what implementations have you seen to be the biggest use case of AI voice? You mentioned obviously a couple of sort of SaaS applications that you've started building as well.
Yeah, I mean, there are definitely like outbound use cases. I'm not the most bullish on them. Like, I think
Okay.
it because of all the consent stuff that's
Yeah.
happening in the U.S. But I am seeing a lot of like inbound use cases that are like very interesting across like customer service, across like healthcare, across like fintech and banking and all that kind of stuff for sure. And actually, I'll take that back. I think there are some pretty good outbound use cases like collections and like real estate, like where there are like explicit opt-in consent. I think those are two verticals where we see
Yeah.
a lot of like think consent use cases. And so yeah, that's definitely what we're seeing as like the bigger opportunities. And like if you're looking to know like, oh, like where on aggregate are the best places to focus? Let's like look at the call volume across the US every year. It's like 20% is healthcare, right? Another 20% is like fucking airlines or whatever, and then just like break it down. And then I think there's opportunities to be built on
Yeah.
each one of these like segments of the call volume.
Absolutely. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense to pinpoint it to the most call volume. In terms of outside of AI phone calls, do you think that there's implementation in maybe game design, implementation into like all these really sort of other niche areas?
I've seen a bunch of niche areas. I mean, role play training is a great, interesting vertical. There's also AI girlfriends, right? Like that's
Right.
also, I think, the money making consumer use case I've seen thus far. Other than that, like, I see a lot of experimentation for sure. I haven't seen, like, at least in consumer, a lot of interesting ideas like popping off and becoming sustainable businesses, including therapy. I haven't seen like a one take off there
Right.
either. I think it will come because, we're about to have speech-to-speech models on like our mobile devices, like 4 billion mobile devices in the next like 5, 6 to maybe 12
Yeah.
months. I'm not going to change consumer behavior like quite significantly towards voice, right? Because if you can talk to something like it's a person, you will talk to something like it's a person. So the whole world is about to have this big shift, just as we went from like text to GUI, GUI to voice. When that happens, and as that happens, I think we're going to start seeing a lot more opportunities in consumer. But right now, it's still really early days, so I think it's hard to build something sustainable there.
Yeah, of course. Okay, yeah, it's still a very experimental market. There's still things popping out. So on that, what do you think would be the most innovative thing that you've seen come out built on the Vapi platform, or are they more sort of in that similar range?
I mean, that's a very tough question. Yeah, because yeah, how do you measure innovative? Like, I definitely see like where I see value accruing is like where are the highest value, highest quantity of high value phone calls right now? And it's like appointment scheduling for like healthcare. Each one of these patients coming in is like 1,000 LTV for the clinic. And so
Right.
if the person doesn't pick up the phone and they go to the foot doctor across the street, like that's terrible, right? Or a collections call, like if someone doesn't make that call, then like that payment never actually gets received. And so there's I think these like high value calls that are definitely quite interesting. Outside of that, when we think of innovative, the problem is like there's just like thousands, and they're all
Yeah,
so
yeah.
weird that I don't even know like which one to like look at specifically. Like we see like mystery shoppers, like for example, on the platform. Some people like building these things like to call like Rexall and like pretend to talk to the customer
Right,
service
yeah.
agent to see how good they are at what they're doing and to like keep them on their toes. Like obviously like the whole character market is also interesting. People want to talk to like their favorite, manga, character, or like whatever it might be. So yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff. And of course, like on the product layer, there's also lots of interesting like dialers in like real estate for like keeping track of like leads and that kind of thing. Patient engagement platforms for like chiropractic clinics. Like there's all sorts of like different layers of the stack that we're seeing
Yeah.
stuff, and tons of small little startups doing lots of
Yeah,
weird things.
absolutely.
So
Well, I
the
think,
hardware device too. Yeah, I've
yeah.
seen like teddy bear with that being it.
Yeah. That's pretty awesome right there. So, I mean, pretty much, as you said, the technology in itself is already insanely innovative as it is, and really just solving the basic use cases, basic appointment setting is already a huge benefit to businesses. You don't even have to extend much further than that. That's already solving a really big use case. So that's great.
Yeah, it's like those calls, like, well, not only is it capturing calls that already exist and are handled by a human, but it's capturing more calls, like
Right.
calls that couldn't have been answered. So it's like effectively like more revenue for that business than they could have had otherwise.
Yeah, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. So in terms of the industries or businesses that you think have seen the most benefit, I suppose you've already sort of outlined that in real estate, the home services type of stuff.
I think definitely. I think home services is great. Real estate is great. If you're looking at the enterprise angle, I think any technical first company that has call center agents is an opportunity. Because call centers have 40% attrition every year. And there's a lot of work retraining and restaffing and managing all these human staff. And a lot of that can be shifted, at least the very simple tier one requests can definitely be shifted to LLMs for sure. So there's that side of things. There's opportunities in application layer. That's the thing. Like phone is such a universal interface for every industry. The whole world runs on the telephone. You could argue more than it does on the internet, at least for a lot of things. And so I think anywhere there's a phone call, there's an opportunity to build something. So I would do that thing if you want to know where, find the value of these phone calls and the quantity of these phone calls and break it down by category. Yep. And I think you'd find an opportunity.
Yeah, awesome. What do you think has been probably one of the most technically challenging parts of actually building Vapi itself? I'm going to follow up this question with the real-time API and how that's going to integrate into the tech stack and what that means for the future. Yeah. But for now, what do you think has been sort of the most challenging part of building it?
Yeah. Well, one, the number of configuration points in the API, there's thousands of them. There's thousands of different paths of 8 layers deep of complexity that we've thought of or had to think of. Just every single parameter you see in there is the result of a customer request and us thinking about how the fuck are we going to put this in the API and have it all be consistent and have it all make sense and us finding a way to do that thousands of times over. So that's one thing. The second thing that was quite hard is determinism. We're still trying to solve this problem, but LLMs, as you know, can go off the rails. They cannot stick to the prompting, especially with smaller, faster models. Yeah. And so we're trying to build out a way to have deterministic conversation flows that still sound and feel generative. So always confirm first name, confirm last name, and then you pull the test results that you shouldn't be sharing with their mother. That's the super critical stuff that businesses really need. They need those guarantees. And so that's one really big area of focus. The second hardest thing is just scaling the whole operation. Scaling to tens of thousands or millions of concurrent calls is a very significant infrastructure problem, because it's a very exotic architecture to have all these long-lived stateful jobs. They're stateful because a call needs to be pinned to a worker the whole time, because there's such low latency requirements that it all has to be within one box. And so this is something that doesn't come out of the box with existing infrastructure. And so there's a ton of custom work that needs to go into making sure that these things can scale and that you can maintain 3 nines of reliability, hopefully one day 4 nines of reliability on these calls.
Yeah. And how much of it is affected by the fact that there are, I think it's around 5 different sort of things connecting together. You got the text-to-speech with the AI
not
models.
Even thinking about those parts. Yeah. Right. That's just our bit. And then there's those other pieces. For example, OpenAI just is slow.
Yeah.
Sometimes. And you have to build solutions balancing across different models and deployments and that kind of thing to get around that. Text-to-speech providers sometimes fail and you need fallbacks for those. Transcription usually is actually pretty good. And so there's all this measuring and workarounds that we have built into the platform that other people don't have to worry about. And frankly, that a lot of people take for granted thinking about using Vapi or building it themselves. It's been a thousand hard lessons to get to the point where it is today.
Yeah, no, I can imagine. So jumping right off of that into the real-time API, what do you think is the next sort of step of these agents? Is it to use the real-time API and integrate this new OpenAI tech to streamline the calls? Is it to not use that and then to just upgrade the infrastructure offside of it? What's the goal here?
Real-time API is definitely the move. Right now we live in the cascaded model world. The next will be in the speech-to-speech, real-time API kind of world. And then there's real-time speech-to-speech, which is, I think real-time API is a bit misnamed. But there are models that are coming out in maybe a 6 to 12 month time horizon that receive audio in real time and produce audio in real time in both directions. Kind of how you and me are and you just said right while I was speaking, right? That's a bidirectional audio
Yeah,
stream.
yeah, yeah.
With the other thing is like strict turn taking. So we're about to get to level two, which is sick. And we have every, I mean, we're working on this right now, making it so that our users have all the exact same platform, the same determinism, the same configuration that they need to plug into like their actual tool calling endpoints, et cetera. But it all works the same and they can just flip to real time with a switch. That's what we're hoping for with the platform. And then same goes when we move from that real-time API to like real-time speech-to-speech, whether we run our own open source models or we wait for someone to do it themselves. Ideally, it will just be like switching from one model to the next, because that's how we built our entire architecture, just betting that models will improve drastically over time. And so we want to ride that wave and be as modular as possible.
Yeah. Okay. Awesome. And then in terms of Vapi's obviously playing this, then obviously Vapi comes in and connects that API to Twilio phone providers and then manages that calling infrastructure, the concurrent call limit, actually managing those calls in real time and then scaling that to the thousands, tens of thousands of users.
Yeah, totally. We actually now run our own like telephony stack in-house as well.
Okay.
You're connecting via SIP, your own telephony like enterprise system. You can just plug in directly, or a dialer, you can plug in directly. And soon we'll eventually just be like purchasing phone numbers directly from like carriers, and we're just going to be our own Twilio as well in-house. So you get to save a lot on those Twilio fees.
Awesome. So what do you actually see Vapi being in the next 5 to 10 years? What do you think is the sort of ultimate vision? Skip to the future. Obviously, you mentioned real-time speech-to-speech, getting that infrastructure out there. What do you think is the end goal, or at least from the perspective as today, in 5 to 10 years, for these models, for these phone systems?
I think it's kind of hard to say. What I do know is that large enterprises move slow. And if they move slow, they are going to still exist in 5 to 10 years, regardless of if AGI actually comes or not. And so we are just going to find ways to continue deepening the value that we provide our customers. Right now it's determinism. Then it's like speech to speech. Then maybe it's like converting raw prompts into like, you know, call flows. And then it's like testing those call flows automatically. And like, you know, just kind of keep spiraling. But our end goal is just to stay nimble as a platform and as a team, so that we can just like ride these model waves. And, you know, whatever comes out with speech to speech next, there's going to be new challenges, and we're going to be the first to try to solve them, and make sure that companies and developing developer teams can actually deploy like the latest voice models as fast as possible. So that's where our focus is. I don't know exactly what that looks like.
No worries. We'll
everywhere, and it's not everywhere yet. So
yeah, do you see Vapi expanding outside of voice agents, maybe into the realm of some other area of AI and implementing, whether that's, obviously you mentioned that voice is really the key area of interacting with AI, but do you think that Vapi is looking at or has contemplated moving into other areas?
It's not in the docs yet, but we did, and it is in the API, we did launch video avatars actually recently in partnership with Tab. So now you can do like build like AI roleplay products and that kind of thing. So that's new. Maybe one day we expand to the like text medium. Once like, you know, conversation workflows become like a large chunk of the product, potentially. It just is like so early and voice is still so unsolved that that's not really what we're thinking about yet.
Okay, no worries. But yeah, there's definitely a market there for the character. Obviously, there's a few different companies out there.
I don't know. Like the landscape is just going to change so much over the next, like even just like 6 months, years, that we just need to keep our heads on a swivel and just keep building.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, cool. That's pretty much it. Thanks for the call.
Of course. Yeah.
Awesome. Cheers. Have a great day. Bye.
Thank you for watching that interview. If you did want to learn a little bit more about the Vapi platform and AI phone agents, definitely check out this 2-hour tutorial where I cover everything there is to know about AI voice agents.